When we think of substances on the periodic table, we generally have a tendency to divide them into one of three categories. The largest category, of course, are the metals. The category are the non-metals. There's a small number of elements on the periodic table which we classify as semi-metals. What makes a substance a metal, a non-metal, and a semi-metal? What is it that helps us understand how the electrons behave in those substances and determine their conductivity? Aware, of course, that metals are very good conductors. Now, there's a range of substances in the metals category, and some are more conductive than others. Gold is a better conductor than iron, for example. And of course, in our non-metals, we clearly have substances that are very good insulators. They don't conduct any electricity at all. And there's the semiconductors like germanium and silicon. They do conduct electricity as long as the conditions are right. In this video, I want to talk specifically what the factor is that determines their conductivity. And I'm going to introduce the concept of the band theory. And hopefully in this video, you'll come away with a better understanding of what it is that is occurring at the molecular level that determines a substance's ability to conduct, whether it is a metal, a non-metal, or a semi-metal. Before we start talking about band theory, let's quickly review the structure of the atom. As you know, the atom consists of a nucleus with electrons that are in orbit around it. And these orbits are in discrete shells. So let's take atoms such as sodium. We know it's sodium that, as long as it's neutral, it has 11 protons and 11 electrons. And these are arranged in depending on how many electrons can be held in each shell. And so we have 2 in the inner shell, we have 8 in the next shell, and then we have 1 in the outermost shell. This electron here, which is very loosely held, in fact, and it actually contributes to the reactivity of sodium, actually also is referred to as the valency shell. So the valency shell is simply the shell that contains some or electrons in the outermost shell. Now, because this particular shell is at the outermost and the electrons aren't tightly held, this electron actually, under a potential difference, is free to move. And so this particular area or shell is actually also referred to as the conduction band. In other words, this electron doesn't require any energy to become conductive. It is already in an energy state that allows it to become conductive. But what happens if we have a different atom? In this case, we have chlorine. Now, chlorine has 7 electrons in its outermost shell, and as a result, these electrons are actually quite tightly held. The outermost shell is still called the valency band. It is the actual outermost shell, and therefore it contains the valency electrons, 7 in this case. But these electrons are held tightly. They do not have enough energy to become conductive, staying in this position. In order to become conductive, they actually have to move to the conduction band, but is now in a new shell. There are no electrons, in this case for chlorine, in this conduction band. However, for an electron to go from the valency band to the conduction band, in order to become used for conduction, it needs to cross a forbidden gap. According to Bohr's theories, an electron can have enough energy to be in this shell, it can have a certain amount of energy to be in this shell, high amount of energy, but it cannot exist in between. So in order to get from this shell to this shell, it needs a very specific amount of energy. And in terms of insulators, this is actually quite a large gap to overcome. Now let's talk about band theory. So imagine now our valency and our conduction bands represented by 2 boxes. In this case, we are going to represent a conductor. So here's a conductor, and a conductor has a conduction band that overlaps the valency band, such as this. As you can see, it's represented by an increasing amount of energy as we go up. So because they overlap, any electrons that exist in the valency band is automatically in the conduction band. There is no gap for them to have to traverse in order to become conductors. In other words, outermost electrons are free to conduct. What about an insulator? Well, an insulator also has a valency band and a conduction band. There is quite a large separation or forbidden gap, in this case for the insulator, for the electrons in the valency band to get to the conduction band. Because this gap is quite large, and it can range 6 to 7, 8, 9 electron volts, then we say these electrons, because they're unable to get into the conduction band, are therefore unable to become conductive, and hence it is an insulator. But what about the third situation? How about a semiconductor? Well, a semiconductor also has a valency band and a conduction band. There is also a gap. However, the forbidden gap is much smaller. And so for an electron to move from the valency band to the conduction band, it does require a certain amount of energy to move from the valency band to conduction band, but the energy can be gained through thermal energy. So for example, if I have a semiconductor such as germanium, it only needs about 1.1 electron volts to traverse it. How do I manage to do that? Well, I simply heat up the substance. And as long as it is above 0 degrees Kelvin, then there may be enough energy for electrons to move from the valency band to the conduction band. And of course, once they're in the conduction band, they're free to become a conductor. And they will conduct if I apply electric field to them or apply a potential difference across them. I now want to give you a bit of an analogy to help you understand the band theory. And in this analogy, I'm going to model the band theory by using this piece of metal. And you can see that this metal consists basically of a smooth surface, small divots here, and then a large divots here. And the surface of the metal is going to represent our conduction band. It is the place where the electrons are free to become conductive. And that's going to be represented by our marbles. And they're free to move. And of course, if I want to apply a potential difference, I simply have to tip it. And so as you can see, by tipping it, I can clearly have the electrons moving in one direction. So let's go and discuss how these divots represent our various substances. If I place my marbles in the largest divot, you can see that these electrons are really fixed and no amount of potential difference is going to make them move. Shaking them isn't going to cause them to move. What that means is that the amount of energy required for these electrons, so to speak, to pop up to this conduction band is so large that the electrons are not able to do so and therefore stay in the valency band. And so we classify this area as our insulator. The gap between the valency band and the conduction band is just too large to overcome. And similarly, it is clear to understand that this ball bearing or marble clearly either sits on the surface or is in the actual divot. And that, of course, represents that an electron does not exist somewhere in between the two bands. In other words, that's why we refer to it as the forbidden gap. But what if I have my electrons in these divots here? Now clearly, again, they're fixed, and as long as there's no energy, in this case the energy is vibrational energy, and that is going to be temperature, then the electrons are not free to move. They stay in the valency band. And if I apply a potential difference, they stay put. But as soon as I start to vibrate it, you can see that they are free to move. In other words, I've provided them enough energy to pop out of the divot, and as a result, they are going into the conduction band and are free to move. Similarly speaking, these divots here do the same job. Again, if there is no energy to the actual substance, they're fixed, they're not going to move. However, if I produce a small amount of energy, in this case vibrating it, which represents an increase in temperature, they are free to move. And if I apply a potential difference, you can see that they are moving off in one direction. And so this region here, these two divots, represents our semiconductors. You could argue that this having a larger divot means a larger forbidden gap, and that would be something like silicon, which is about 1.1 electron volts forbidden gap, and germanium only 0.7. And of course, clearly, in this case, the electrons along this surface are free to move. They don't need any energy whatsoever to move from their position. And so this area here represents the metal. So we have our insulator, we have our semiconductor, and we have our metal. And each have their differences due to the place where the electrons are and the circumstances that are required for the electrons to become conductive if they are in the conduction band. Now, one word of caution. This is clearly a model for band theory. Although it is simplistic and it explains aspects of band theory, it is a model nonetheless, which means it does have some limitations. And that's an important thing to consider, that models are useful in science and therefore can explain complex concepts in simplistic terms, but they have their limitations. They do not explain everything. And in this case, my metal sheet has its limitations. It does not explain everything about band theory. But hopefully with the animation and this particular demonstration, you'll have a better understanding of band theory.